Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues on the dais, very warm welcome and good evening. I'm sure you are enjoying your day so far. I believe you are having a very good time, very productive discussions all around across three halls. I'm indeed honored and privileged to be here chairing this session and also be speaking thanks to Energy Environment Foundation and especially Anil Garg Saab. He's been personally pursuing that I should come and be a part of this whole gala event. So thank you once again, ma'am is right here. And so we have some very, very accomplished people here on this panel today. And I'm equally excited to hear what they have to share. We have been talking a lot about since yesterday, a lot about issues and challenges in regards to water availability. And in fact, one of the speakers yesterday, Mr. Sanjay Rana of Eco Foundation, he said there has been more efforts and energy being put in extracting water than, you know, recharging water resources or conserving them. So perhaps we'll be talking a little bit more about solution then, like previous speakers, and also touching upon few issues in regards to solutions as such, technology interventions. And I'm sure my fellow speakers here, they will bring in their perspective when it comes to sustainable water conservation. And I think with this, I will start with a little presentation about the foundation that we are promoting. We want to take you through a few slides, set of slides about what we are doing in terms of rainwater harvesting. I'll be very focused and very brief about what we are trying to promote. There's a new and improvised model of rainwater harvesting system that we felt it is worth sharing with the world. In fact, it is not a fairly new, I mean, India has a very long history, in fact, almost 1,000 years of history of rainwater harvesting. But what we conventionally do, let me ask you a question. How many of you have actually seen a functional rainwater harvesting system? And they are fully functional, right? But most cases I hear, thank you so very much, most cases I hear and I keep getting complaints from people that rainwater harvesting system do not necessarily work properly because of various reasons, maintenance, choking, or et cetera, et cetera. Sometimes, you know, walls getting collapsed because of rains and heavy monsoon shower. So what we have brought out, it's a joint initiative between Professor and Academician, Professor Giridhar from JNTU Hyderabad. In fact, Head of the Department, Honorable Rao Sahib is also here from JNTU Hyderabad Center for Water Resources and Institute of Science and Technology. So let me take this pride privilege of sharing this model with everybody else, and also since Sir is also here representing the same department, it's my honor and privilege that we have somebody supporting our back about this model that we are promoting. So I'll quickly run through the slides. So like many of our previous speakers have mentioned that, you know, in India, the scarcity of water is mostly man-made. And so that's the reason I thought of, you know, starting with this SDG Goal 6. In fact, our previous speaker also mentioned extensively about sustainable development goals. So so what are we doing about it? Of course, we know there's a problem, and what can be done about it? What are we doing about it, and what can be done about it? So the problems we all know. Problems are, of course, depletion of groundwater storage. That is, the aquifers are drying. And in many cases, we keep hearing about this now, more alarming than the availability, that is the contamination of groundwater. Right in the source itself, aquifer itself is contaminated both because of natural and man-made reasons. And of course, you see, although India has been one of the richest countries in the world in terms of its freshwater resources and surface water bodies, like ponds, rivers, and lakes, but they're also drying. I mean, look at Delhi, look at Bangalore, look at Hyderabad. It's the city is known to be known as a city of lakes. It's now you barely see lakes anymore. So this, of course, I'm not going to repeat it again because in a previous session also this slide was shown. I mean, this infographic, the 50% of groundwater wells are drying in India. So I'm not going to go into that because you all know our facts and figures have been, you have been bombarded with facts and figures and statistics so far. So I'm not going to go deeper into statistics again. So I'll quickly touch upon, you know, when I said the more than availability, the contamination water has become more, it's a bigger challenge now because we know that that has been one of our major source of water, especially, I mean, according to this World Water Report, which is released by UNESCO, it said India has been the highest extractor of groundwater, which is about 60 to 70%, and out of this water that has been extracted from groundwater, about 70% is consumed in the agriculture sector. And now, if that water itself is polluted, then what can you expect? The water that is being, in fact, I remember seeing one report a few years ago about Noida, the Noida groundwater, even now, Noida, Greater Noida, unfortunately, if you look at the groundwater quality, TDS level is about 2,000, 2,500, sometime 2,800, that is the TDS level. And above anything above 2,000, which is considered as not fit for even agriculture use, for irrigation purpose. And that is the state of our groundwater today. And the other problem, apart from the other problem, is the availability. So availability, one of the measures, in fact, one of our previous speakers touched upon today, that urbanization. So what urbanization did to, I mean, what has urbanization to do with the groundwater availability? Any, yes ma'am, please.
So we are actually reducing the contact. I will be doing that in my slide,
okay.
Maybe.
Okay, nevertheless. So of course, urbanization has a deeper impact on water availability when it comes to, because by making everything concrete, especially the surfaces, we call it imperviousness. So we are losing soft areas everywhere. Almost all the areas we see or areas we walk upon, public spaces, garden space, parks, including other societies, everything has been concrete. So that means we are actually reducing the possibility of groundwater aquifers getting richer naturally. So what happens is, as a result, look at Bangalore. Bangalore is a classic example. Bangalore and Cape Town has been rated as one of the most vulnerable cities in the world. They're going to go dry ground as far as groundwater is concerned, going to go dry in next couple of years, maybe in a year's time. Why is it so? You'll be surprised, in last year alone, that is between 2018 to 2019, Bangalore received highest amount of rainfall. It's a record rainfall in 70 years. Still, the groundwater source dry. Reason being, this is one of the reasons. I'll show you a little infographic. This, what happens is you have rainfalls and a few percentage goes up, few percent goes down, and few percentage goes away as a runoff. But the moment we start creating construction here, you have that percentage reducing day by day. So you can see the percentage, 38% evapotranspiration, 20% runoff, and 42% infiltration. Now you see more construction happening. Look at the percentage below, 35. It is from 42 to 40, it went down to 35. Then again you see more construction coming. It went down to 15, and eventually it will be none. And this is the exact situation that we are looking at now. Rain is happening, we've not been able to harvest it. And what's happening? There's no water in the tap. Even our Honorable Prime Minister has to raise an alarm. He said, why only 80% of rainwater water has been harvested so far? Only 8%, which is like a crime. I believe You know, we talk about doing seva and service to the mankind. I believe every single drop of water saved is a huge service to the mankind. If we are not able to do that, then we are doing injustice to the mankind, and also we are doing injustice to ourselves. So our solution is this, very simple. I have borrowed this photograph from Delhi Jal Board. So we have this model. You may have seen or experienced this model. This is a very, very popular, commonly used, conventional model of rainwater harvesting. What we do is we create a pit. The entire collection, either rooftop collection or the surface collection, is diverted into that little pit, recharge pit. But many a times what happens, because we do not necessarily study the geology or do not understand where the aquifers lie, that water never reaches the groundwater table. And also because of geology. For example, I'm told Delhi NCR has quite a chunk of granite. So if you are exercising this, it may or may not actually be going down to the aquifers because of the rock formation that is there underneath. So what we need is we need something else which is different. So what we do is, this is again a not new technology entirely, but we have improvised on it. We're using injection bores to bring the water down into whatever water is collected, it is filtered, and then it is taken down into our aquifer straight away. And what we do is, we study the geology, we study the about 30 years of rainfall pattern of the particular area, and design the structure accordingly so that it can take enough of water down into the aquifer. And we have two pits in most cases, in one pit we have two injection bore. One goes to confined aquifer and one goes to unconfined aquifer, so that you have enough of water going down and recharging the aquifer effectively on a very fast manner. So this is a conventional model. This is a photograph from JNTU campus. So I'm not going to go into this video. So now I'm going to give you a little very unusual perspective on rainwater harvesting, what it is doing more than recharging the water. Will you believe that we have been able to also solve a problem like fluoride in groundwater just by doing rainwater harvesting? Pollutants are what? We only look at concentration, right? I mean, when we look at the permissible limit is also a concentration. Lower concentration is obviously permissible, higher concentration is not acceptable for human consumption or otherwise. So what happens is, if you bring in fresh water to a place or the aquifer which is underground and it is concentrated with heavy metal such as fluoride or arsenic, and if you pour more water, fresh water, what happens? The concentration goes down, and that is what has exactly happened. This is a case study from Nalgonda district of Telangana. And in one season, you can look at, it's a study between May 17 to September 2018, and we have been able to see this drastic change. Permissible limit is 1.5 for fluoride, and you look at the figure, it's 1.36. This has happened after one rains alone. See? This has gone to 2.28, this is 1.04, this is slightly higher, of course, this is also slightly higher. But in most cases, it has came down from like 7 to, it came down to 2.5, which is like a huge, huge breakthrough. And this is only, has become possible because we have been able to bring the water down into the aquifers. So there are certain advantages. Of course, this is a low-cost model, low-cost, low-maintenance model, and the retention time is also low, so that you don't have any problem of water, like water logging or mosquito breeding, etc., etc. And obviously, since the model is slightly different than the conventional model, so obviously we are not doing a lot of construction work, a lot of civil work is not required, so cost is being brought down. So that's what I wanted to share with you, but I will also throw a little light on what other than this one that we do. We as an organization, Global Foundation is an Indian-American joint initiative, and we have a very broad focus on environment, starting from water to climate change to biodiversity to sustainable agriculture. But most of our work is focused around using technology for good, using technology. And technology is like this. We don't really go on very complicated technologies. We use basic technology. We believe in learning from our culture, learning from our basics. And that is what exactly we are trying to do. And also for restoration of water water bodies like lakes and ponds, and also for treating waters with ecotechnologies like constructed wetland and floating island. So there are some cases happening and experimentation happening successfully across different places. And this constructed wetland is it's a joint effort between IIT Bombay and us, and this is again with JNTU Hyderabad and us. And another thing that we also do as part of our, because since this is a water forum, I thought I'll also touch upon this, because what happens to most of our water bodies today, there's a unwanted alien plant called water hyacinth, jalkumbhi, Hindi mein bolte. So the water hyacinth is absolutely unwanted because it creates nuisance to the water body. It creates a whole lot of things, ecological unbalance to the water body. What we do, we use them for wider public utility and also create a livelihood out of it by using them as raw material for handicraft such as this. And though also we are now trying to create paper out of this pulp so that we can make eco-friendly, degradable paper plates. So this is what is happening.
Heavy metals are there in the water.
But residual, this thing is very low. So after use is not much. So they extract, but it's not there. Residual effect is not there.
Do you do any pre-treatment of that?
No, we are not doing. It's drying, not natural drying. Natural dying. But I'm told it's the residual effect is not there. But maybe it's worth looking into. Thank you so much. So yeah, that's about from my side. So I'm going to invite our colleagues on the dais one by one. And I think, what is the time now? How much time do we have for the whole session? Till 5:30. We have only about, the time is short. Can we take about 7-8 minutes per person? Yeah, that should be okay, sir. Yes, sir, please.
You mentioned about fluorine content.
Fluoride, yes. Absolutely, sir. Right, sir. Right.
But I would like to know the level of fluorine you measure.
Right.
After monsoon.
Right.
After
a period of time, because this study was done over a period of 1 year.
Okay, was the levels taken immediately after monsoon or after?
Immediately after monsoon and afterwards also.
Was there any difference?
There was difference. More or less stabilized, but it's much lower than the pre-record.
Because we cannot take fluorine as an indicator,
right,
for reduction of heavy metals.
Right.
Because fluorine is actually from the rock salts.
Absolutely.
Because the water at the time of rainwater harvesting.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. No, completely agreed. But provided if we are able to bring in more water to the table, because the water, the concentration is going up, because the water level is going down because of more extraction happening. So at the same time, if you are able to recharge it, so obviously you'll be able to stabilize the concentration over a long period of time. That is what is happening in Kokatpally area also. The entire area, Kokatpally area, most of the people used to do bore. Now they are saying our water level has automatically gone up because of the rainwater harvesting being done within the campus of JNTU.
That is a very good suggestion, but chlorine should not be taken as an indicator for heavy metal reduction, because chlorine actually
brought
from the rock salt.
Yeah, it is.
So I think we can take some.
No, but what has happened, sir? What has happened now? The water has become potable. After doing the rainwater harvesting, at least people are able to drink this water. Earlier, it was not possible. Thank you, sir. Thanks so much. I think we'll take in one go. Yeah. I think it will be ideal to take the questions in one go. At the end, if that is okay with you. Okay. Maybe we can connect over. Sorry. So should I and start inviting from my next. Yeah. So, sorry. Ah, Bhaskar, hi. I was looking for you. So far, only 8%, which is like it's like a crime. I believe, you know, we talk about doing seva and service to the mankind. I believe every single drop of water saved is a huge service to the mankind. If we are not able to do that, then we are doing injustice to the mankind, and also we are doing injustice to ourselves. So our solution is this, very simple. I have borrowed this photograph from Delhi Jalboard. So we have this model. You may have seen or experienced this model. This is a very, very popular, commonly used, conventional model of rainwater harvesting. What we do is we create a pit. The entire collection, either rooftop collection or the surface collection, is diverted into that little pit, recharge pit. But many a times what happens, sorry, because we do not necessarily study the geology or do not understand where the aquifers lie, that water never reaches the groundwater table. And also because of geology. For example, I'm told Delhi NCR has quite a chunk of granite. So if you are exercising this, it may or may not actually be going down to the aquifers because of the rock formation that is there underneath. So what we need is we need something else which is different. So what we do is, this is again a not new technology entirely, but we have improvised on it. We're using injection bores to bring the water down into whatever water is collected, it is filtered, and then it is taken down into our aquifer straight away. And what we do is we study the geology, we study the about 30 years of rainfall pattern of the particular area, and design the structure accordingly so that it can take enough of water down into the aquifer. And we have two pits in most cases, in one pit we have two injection bore. One goes to confined aquifer and one goes to unconfined aquifer, so that you have enough of water going down and recharging the aquifer effectively on a very fast manner. So this is a conventional model. This is a photograph from JNTU campus. So I'm not going to go into this video. So now I'm going to give you a little very unusual perspective on rainwater harvesting, what it is doing more than recharging the water. Will you believe that we have been able to also solve a problem like fluoride in groundwater just by doing rainwater harvesting? Pollutants are what? We only look at concentration, right? I mean, when we look at the permissible limit is also a concentration. Lower concentration is obviously permissible, higher concentration is not acceptable for human consumption or otherwise. So what happens is, if you bring in fresh water to a place or the aquifer which is underground and it is concentrated with heavy metal such as fluoride or arsenic, and if you pour more water, fresh water, what happens? The concentration goes down, and that is what has exactly happened. This is a case study from Nalgonda district of Telangana. And in one season, you can look at, it's a study between May 17 to September 2018, and we have been able to see this drastic change. Permissible limit is 1.5 for fluoride, and you look at the figure, it's 1.36. This has happened after one rains alone. See? This has gone to 2.28, this is 1.04, this is slightly higher, of course, this is also slightly higher. But in most cases, it has came down from like 7 to, it came down to 2.5, which is like a huge, huge breakthrough. And this is only, has become possible because we have been able to bring the water down into the aquifers. So there are certain advantages. Of course, this is a low-cost model, low-cost, low-maintenance model, and the retention time is also low, so that you don't have any problem of water, like water logging or mosquito breeding, etc., etc. And obviously, since the model is slightly different than the conventional model, so obviously we are not doing a lot of construction work, a lot of civil work is not required, so cost is being brought down. So that's what I wanted to share with you, but I will also throw a little light on what other than this one that we do. We as an organization, we Global Foundation is an Indian-American joint initiative, and we have a very broad focus on environment, starting from water to climate change to biodiversity to sustainable agriculture. But most of our work is focused around using technology for good, using technology, and technologies like this, we don't really go on very complicated technologies. We use basic technology. We believe in learning from our culture, learning from our basics, and that is what exactly we are trying to do. And also for restoration of water, water bodies like lakes and ponds, and also for treating waters with ecotechnologies like constructed wetland and floating island. So there are some cases happening and experimentation happening successfully at, across different places. And this constructed wetland is it's a joint effort between IIT Bombay and us, and this is again with JNTU Hyderabad and us. And another thing that we also do as a part of our, because since this is a water forum, I thought I'll also touch upon this, because what happens to most of our water bodies today, there's a unwanted alien plant called water hyacinth, jalkumbhi, Hindi mein bolte hain. So the water hyacinth is absolutely unwanted because it's it creates nuisance to the water body. It creates a whole lot of things, ecological unbalance to the water body. What we do, we use them for wider public utility and also create livelihood out of it by using them as raw material for handicraft such as this. And though also we are now trying to create paper out of this pulp so that we can make eco-friendly, degradable paper plates. So this is what is happening.
Heavy metals are there in the water.
But residual, this thing is very low. So after use is not much. So they extract, but it's not there. Residual effect is not there.
Do you do any pre-treatment of it?
No, we are not doing. It's drying, not natural drying. Natural dying. But I'm told it's the residual effect is not there. But maybe it's worth looking into. Thank you so much. So yeah, that's about from my side. So I'm going to invite our colleagues on the dais one by one. And I think, what is the time now? How much time do we have for the whole session? Till 5:30. We have only about, the time is short. Can we take about 7-8 minutes per person? Yeah, that should be okay, sir. Yes, sir, please.
Fluoride,
yes. Absolutely, sir. Right, sir. Right.
But I would like to know the level of fluorine you measure.
Right.
After monsoon.
Right.
After
a period of time, because this study was done over a period of 1 year.
Okay, what about the levels taken immediately after monsoon or after?
Immediately after monsoon and afterwards also.
Was there any difference?
There was difference. More or less stabilized, but it's much lower than the pre-record.
Because we cannot take fluorine as an indicator,
right,
for reduction of heavy metals.
Right.
Because fluorine is actually from the rock salts.
Absolutely.
Because the water at the time of rainwater harvesting.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. No, completely agreed. But provided if we are able to bring in more water to the table, because the water, the concentration is going up, because the water level is going down because of more extraction happening. So at the same time, if you are able to recharge it, so obviously you'll be able to stabilize the concentration over a long period of time. That is what is happening in Kokatpally area also. The entire area, Kokatpally area, most of the people used to do bore. Now they are saying our water level has automatically gone up because it's because of the rainwater harvesting being done within the campus of JNTU.
That is a very good suggestion, but fluorine should not be taken as an indicator for heavy metal reduction because fluorine actually is brought from the rock salt.
Yeah, it is.
So I think we can take some.
No, but what has happened, sir? What has happened now? The water has become potable. After doing the rainwater harvesting, at least people are able to drink this water. Earlier, it was not possible. Thank you, sir. Thanks so much.